Hello everyone. Today we are going to discuss about the design of singly reinforced beam. Here we are having one problem. So a rectangular reinforced concrete beam is simply supported on two masonry walls, 230 mm thick and 6 meter apart. So within the bracket it is clear span. The beam is carrying an imposed load of 15 kN per meter. Design the beam with all necessary checks. Use M25 concrete and Fe415 steel. This is our problem. They given the masonry wall thickness and the length of the beam and imposed load, nothing but the live load. And we are using M25 concrete and Fe415 steel. For these details, we are going to design a beam. So first, write down the given things. So solution. So in that given things, the given width of the wall, nothing but you can call it as width of the support or width of the wall, BWR, B suffix WR, B suffix S, both are same. So is equal to 230 mm, they given. And length is given to you, L value is given to you, L is equal to 6 meter, it's a clear span. Okay, inside dimension they given, it is 6 meter. Then the beam is carrying imposed load, nothing but live load is equal to 15 kN per meter. That will be the uniformly distributed load acting on the beam. Then we are using M25 concrete and Fe415 steel, nothing but FCK is 25 Newton per mm square and Fy is 415 Newton per mm square. So for these details, we need to design a beam. So first, we need to calculate the cross-section dimension. Means we need to assume the value, assume the width, assume the value of depth, and we need to calculate the effective length. After that, we need to go for the further calculation. So first step is calculation of cross-section dimension. Of cross section dimensions. So in this, first assume overall depth is nothing but capital D. Overall depth is assumed to be within the range L by 12 to L divided by 15. This will be the range for simply supported beam. L is nothing but the length divided by 12 to L by 15. This will be the assumption actually. So in this range, we are going to take the overall depth and also assume width of the beam will be equal to depth by 2 to depth by 3. This will be the range. This is by experience, we can say this will be the overall depth L by 12 to L by 15 for simply supported beam, and D is equal to D by 2 to D by 3 for simply supported beam. So within the range, this range only we need to assume. If it is okay, then we can continue the calculation. Otherwise, we need to increase the value. Okay. Now, I am going to assume L by 12 itself. So because the live load is 15 kN per meter, so means it's a higher value. So that's why I'm assuming L by 12. If it is 5 or 10, go for the ratio L by 15 or L by 14 or 30. So here the load is more. That's why I'm taking L by 12. So now I will take D is equal to length divided by 12 will be the ratio I am going to assume. So that is nothing but D is equal to length is 6 meter divided by 12. So I will get this one as 6 by 12, nothing but I got it as 0.5 meter, because length is in meter. So I got it as 0.5 meter. So we can say that D is equal to 0.5 meter, nothing but 500 mm. This will be the value we are going to assume. Overall depth is 500 mm. Then after knowing the overall depth, we can calculate the width of the beam. So I will assume it as b is equal to d by 2. D by 2 nothing but 500 divided by 2. Okay, by this ratio we can say it is 500 by 2. So we will get b is equal to 250 mm. Okay, 250 mm will be the b value. So means we got the cross section of the beam. The cross section of the beam is 250 divided by 500 in mm, 500 mm. This will be the overall cross section of the beam. Then we need to calculate the effective depth. Okay, to calculate the effective depth, assume cover. I am going to assume the cover, minimum cover for beam is 25. I am going to assume it as 30 mm cover. I will assume it as 30 mm cover. If I assume that 30 mm cover, effective depth is given by overall depth minus effective cover. So this will give 500 minus 30, nothing but it is the effective depth small d is equal to 470 mm. I got the effective depth also, means small b, small d and capital D are calculated. So this is what one of the important step, calculation of the cross section dimension. After getting the values, so we need to calculate the effective span. Okay, effective span we need to find. So effective span is given in the code book as per the clause number 22.2 of IS 456. Okay, I will show that code book. So in this page number 34, clause number 22.2, which is referring for the effective span. So in this class we are having, for simply supported beam, it is 22.2a. for simply supported beam or slab, the effective span of a member that is not built integrally with its supports shall be taken as clear span plus the effective depth of slab or beam or center to center of supports, whichever is lesser. So in these two values, whichever is lesser will be the effective span. Means as per that clause, the effective span will be calculated as like this. We are having simply supported beam with the supports masonry wall. The width of the masonry wall is given to you. Width of the wall is 230 mm, which is given in the problem itself. 230 mm. And clear span is 6 meter, nothing but 6000 mm. Okay, so effective span LE, we need to calculate the LE value, effective span of the beam, affected length of the beam, as per the IS 456 clause number 22.2a. so for simply supported beam, LE should be of lesser of two value, right? So it should be lesser of these two value. So first value is length plus effective depth, length plus width of the support by 2 plus width of the support by 2. Center to center of the support, nothing but width by 2, width of the support by 2 plus length will give the value, and whichever is lesser, that will be the value of effective length. So here in this class, LE is equal to L is 6 meter, nothing but 6000 plus the effective depth we considered, we assumed it as 470, nothing but this value is 6470 mm. Or okay, length is 6000 plus width of the support is 230 divided by 2 plus 230 by 2, nothing but this value is 6230 mm. We got two values, one is 6470, another value is 6230. So whichever is lesser will be the effective span. Which one is the lesser? 6230 means 6.23 meter will be the effective length of this beam. Therefore, effective length is equal to 6.23 meter. I got four unknowns. One is overall depth, it is for 500 mm, and width of the beam B is equal to 250 mm, and effective depth is 470, and effective length is 6.23 meter. After this, next we will move on to the calculation of load. Now in the calculation of loads, we need to calculate dead load or self weight of the beam, then the live load is already given. After that, we need to calculate the total load and factored load. First, I will calculate the dead load or self weight of the beam. Dead load is given by, we know the cross section dimension. The cross section dimension, we assumed it as 0.25 by 0.5 meter. This will be the cross sectional area of the beam we have assumed, and the unit weight of the RCC is 25 kilonewton per meter cube. Now I will move on to the calculation of the dead load. Dead load is given by the cross sectional area. It is 0.5 into 0.25, nothing but the cross sectional area 0.25 multiplied by 0.5 multiplied by density of the, means unit weight of the RCC is 25. So we will get the answer as 3.125 kilonewton per meter. Means in this cross section, for 1 meter length of the beam, for 1 meter length of the beam, this will be the self weight or dead load of the singly whatever the beam we have considered, 3.125 kilonewton per meter. Then live load, in the problem itself they given live load or imposed load is 15 kilonewton per meter. If I add both the value, so total load W, you can call W is equal to 18.125 kilonewton per meter. This will be the total load acting on the beam, including the self weight. So for design purpose, we are not going to consider this value, because as per the limit state method, we need to overestimate the load. Means we need to multiply it by some factor of safety. So we will get design load, or you can call it as factor load, which is given by WU is equal to W multiplied by factor of safety for load. As per the IS 456, factor of safety for load is 1.5, means 18.125 multiplied by 1.5, we will get WU or factor load. We can call it as design load is 25. So 18.125 multiplied by 1.25, nothing but, so we will get 27.18 kilonewton per meter. This will be the factor load. Okay, so we got the factor load. After calculating the factor load, we need to calculate bending moment and shear force. Now the third step is calculation of bending moment and shear force, nothing but MU and VU. So we know that for simply supported beam subjected to UDL, W kilonewton per meter, the bending moment diagram is parabolic shape, and maximum bending moment is WL square by 8. This will be the formula for bending moment. So bending moment diagram, and we know that shear force is maximum at the supports and zero at the middle. So we know the shear force will be WL by 2. This will be the shear force value. This one is sagging bending moment. To calculate the MU, we are having a formula WULE square by 8. So WL square by 8 is the formula. So we need to consider factored load and effective length for the calculation of the factored bending moment. So MU is equal to MU WULE square divided by 8. So after substituting the values, WUE is 27.18 multiplied by effective length. So we assumed effective length as 6.23 meter. So 6.23 whole square divided by h. So we got mu is equal to 131.86 kilonewton meter. This will be the factored bending moment. Factored bending moment. Then we know the shear force. Shear force is given by maximum shear force for the uniformly distributed load is VU is equal to WU LE by 2 is the formula. So if I substitute the value, it is 27.18 is the factored load multiplied by effective length is 6.23 divided by 2. So we got the shear force, factored shear force VU is equal to 84.66 kilonewton. Okay, so we got bending moment 131.86 kilonewton per kilonewton meter and the VU 84.66 kilonewton. Okay, after calculating bending moment MU and shear force VU, next step is calculation of the maximum neutral axis depth, that is XU max. Fourth step is calculation of maximum neutral axis depth, that is XU max. Depending upon the grade of the steel, XU max by D is varying. As per the clause number 38.1 of IS 456 2000, so we know that for Fe415, XU max by D is 0.48, and if I substitute the value of D in this equation, XU max is equal to 0.48 into 470, it will be the effective depth we have considered. Then the value will be 225.6 mm, means the maximum neutral axis depth is located at 225.6 mm. Okay, after calculating the XU max value, maximum neutral axis depth, we need to calculate the D required, means we need to check whether the depth required is lesser than what we have provided, means our D provided will be more than the D required. That's why we need to check that one. So fifth step will be calculation of D required. Okay, D required means effective depth required. So to calculate the D required, we know that in the annex G, one point clause number G1.1b, for balance section MU limit is equal to 0.36 XU max by D into 1 minus 0.42 into XU max by D into BD square into FCK. This will be the formula for calculation of the MU limit, maximum moment of resistance for balance section. So in this equation, substitute MU limit as MU only, then we will get the D required for the section what we are the moment is applied for. That what will be the D required we are getting. So now I will substitute the value of MU limit XU max by D and B value and FCK value in this above equation. So we know that MU limit is equal to MU only. MU value we got it as 133.22 kilonewton meter. Actually the XU max by D and FCK values are in newton and millimeter, so that's why. So we need to substitute the value of MU limit in terms of newton millimeter. So means 10 raised to 3 for kilonewton to newton, and 10 raised to another 3 for meter to millimeter. So totally it is 10 raised to 6. So now the unit is newton millimeter, 133.22 into 10 raised to 6 newton millimeter. So is equal to 0.36 multiplied by xu max by d. I already know for Fe415 it is 0.48, to 1 minus 0.42 into xu max by d is 0.48. then b is, we have already given the value of b as 250, we assumed that value. Then d value we need to calculate, that d required itself, that is d required, d square into 25 will be the FCK, 25 newton per mm square. Then after simplifying the above equation, only one unknown is d. So therefore d required is equal to, we are getting 393.06 mm. So this will be the d required. Okay, so d provided is 470 mm. This will be the d provided. So means we provided more than the required, nothing but d provided is more than d required. This shows that our section is under reinforced section. Okay, hence our section is under reinforced section, nothing but the concrete is going to fail after the failure of the steel. Means steel is going to fail first, then the concrete is going to fail. That's why it is under reinforced section. If d required is more compared to d provided, on that case we need to redesign it. We need to redesign by increasing the value of d. Okay, so increase the depth. So now in this case it's okay, it is d provided is more than the d required, then we move on to the calculation of the ASD. So next step will be sixth step. Okay, it is calculation of area of steel. Okay, main reinforcement in the tension zone. So sixth step is calculation of area of steel, nothing but AST for tension zone. Okay, for flexure. So as per the class number in the annex G 1.1b, so in the annex G 1.1b, for under reinforced section, moment of resistance equation is given by mu is equal to 0.87 Fi into AST into D into 1 minus AST Fi divided by FCK into B into D. This will be the formula. So this is for under reinforced section. So means we are having the under reinforced section. So steel is going to fail first. So we will have all the values here. Mu value I know, Fi value I know, D value know, FCK, B and D is known to you. Only unknown is AST. So after substituting the values in this equation, so here it is Mu. Mu is 133.22 into 10 raised to 6. 0.87. Fi is 415. And AST is the unknown. Then the effective depth is 470 we have provided. Then 1 minus, so AST we need to calculate. Then 415 will be the Fi value divided by FCK is 25 newton per mm square, 25. Then the width is 250 mm, and D is 470. Keep it in your mind. So it is effective depth. Keep it in your mind. All the values should be in newton, and the length will be in mm. Okay, it is in newton millimeter, newton per mm square. So like that, we are having all the values. After calculating, we are getting here. So the equation will be 785.06 is equal to only one unknown AST, and after simplifying this, 1 minus 1.412 into 10 raised to minus 4 AST. Once again, if I simplify, so this will be AST minus 1.412 into 10 raised to minus 4 AST square is equal to 785.06. Then it will look like a quadratic equation. Then 1.412 into 10 raised to minus 4 into AST square. So if I modify the equation, minus AST, it will be going right side. Then so plus 785.06 is equal to 0. So I made as a quadratic equation. I call this equation as equation number 1. Okay. So in the calculator, if I substitute the value. Okay, now I will explain using the calculator. So if I on the calculator in the second next to the horn, so we are having a setup. So if I click on that, we are having the options. In that, for equations, press 5. So I will press 5. Then the equation, quadratic equation will be 3, means ax square plus bx plus c is equal to 0. This is in the third one, so means I will press on 3. So we got a, b, c are the values. So here ax square minus bx plus c equal to 0. Like this, the quadratic equation, we need to substitute the value. Here the a value is 1.412 into 10 raised to minus 4. Okay. Then after substituting the value of a, so press equals. Then it is asking about the b value is, here it is minus 1, nothing but 1, the value is minus 1 equals. Then we are having the value of c is here 785.06. so press equals, once again equal. So we are getting x1 value, it is the first value, positive value, 6182.91. it's a bigger value, don't consider this. Press below, that is second value, x2 value. So we are getting the x2 value as 899.23. this is the minus value. Okay, so means in the quadratic equation, the solution will be having two values, one is positive and another one is negative. So this is the second value equation. So consider the second value always. So it is the AST value required, AST. Okay, this is the AST required. Value will be 899.23 mm square. This will be the area of steel required. Area of steel required. Okay, we got area required, area of steel required. AST required is equal to 899.23 mm square. This will be the required AST. Now we need to calculate the number of bars. To calculate the number of bars, we are having a formula. So that is AST required divided by cross sectional area of single bar, means pi d square by 4. So we are having the diameter of the bars available in the market is 6 mm dia, 8 mm dia, 10 mm dia, 12, 16, 20, 25, 28, 32, 36, 40, 50 mm dia. These are the diameter of the bars available in the market. So we need to choose the available bar only. So we can't provide 17 mm, we can't provide 15 mm. So in the market we are having 12 mm dia, 16 mm dia, 20 mm dia, 25 mm dia, like that only. So we need to choose with that diameter itself, means I need to go for the trial and error method. Here, by using the calculator, AST required is 899.23 and multiplied by 4, means the denominator will be going to the numerator, means 899.23 into 4 divided by, so pi d square. So I will take the pi into d square. Okay, so I will start with the 12 or 16 mm dia. If I provide 16 mm dia, so 12 mm dia only, I will start with the 12 mm dia, 12 square. Okay, 12 square. So I got 7.9, nothing but 8 bars we got. So we can't provide 7.9 bars. So either it may be 8 or it may be 7. So 7.9 nothing but we need to provide 8 bars. Our width is 250 mm. Our width is 250 mm. We can't provide 8 bars in a single layer. We need to provide in 2 layers, right? So that's why I will increase the diameter of the bar. Okay, so I will increase the diameter of the bar to 16 mm. 16 nothing but 4.47 I got. So which is lesser than 4.5. Is it right? So means we need to provide 5 bars. 5 bars means the D, whatever the ASD provided will be more than the D required. So ASD required. So I will increase slight value over here. I provided 12, so it is not possible because 8 bars is not possible to provide in a single layer, and 16 nothing but 4.47. So I will make it as 20. Next bar diameter will be 20. If I use the 20 mm dia bar, I got 2.86, which is near to 3 rad. So now we can provide this value because so our width is 250, 3 bars in one layer we can easily provide. The spacing between this will be okay within the limit only. So that's why so we can provide 2.86, so nothing but 3 bars. Okay, so means I will provide 899.23 divided by pi d square d. I provided 20 mm dia divided by 4, so I got 2.86. so nothing but we need to provide 3 bars we can provide. Okay, so if I calculate the AST provided, then AST provided, then so it is 3 bars we have provided, means 3 into the area is pi d square by 4, d is 20 square divided by 4. So we will get the value. So it is pi into d square is 20 mm bar, 20 square by 4 multiplied by number of bar is 3. So I got the value as 942.47 mm square. Okay, so this will be the AST provided. So which is more than the AST required. Always AST provided should be more than AST required, means which should be nearly same. Here the difference is nearly 43 mm square. That will not be a bigger value. Okay, so that much we can provide. It should not be more than if it is 1000 mm square, it is not correct because required is 899. If you are providing 1000 or 1050 or 1200, that will be a bigger value. So which is near to that means 900 or 950 will be okay. So means I provided 3 bars of 20 mm dia. So AST provided is 942.47 mm square. So after getting this, we need to check the minimum AST and maximum AST, and also what we have provided. Is this within the limit or not? So for that reason, so seventh step. So this will be the seventh step. Seventh step is check AST provided with minimum and maximum value. Okay, so AST provided with minimum and maximum value. So we know that As per the clause number 26.5.1.1a, minimum AST, minimum area of steel for tension reinforcement. Okay, so minimum AST is given by so AST minimum divided by B into D should be equal to 0.87 Fi divided by, so 0.87 divided by Fy. This will be the formula for minimum area of steel. So it is given in the class number 26.5.1.A. So there they given this formula for calculation of the minimum area of the steel in the tension reinforcement, okay, tension zone. If I substitute the values in this equation, so AST minimum, we need to calculate that one. B is, we provided 250, effective depth is 470 we provided, is equal to 0.87 divided by 415. So we got the AST minimum. After calculation, AST minimum we will get it as 246.3 mm square. Okay, I got AST minimum as 246.3 mm square. So we need to check AST provided with the minimum and maximum value. So now I will move on to the maximum AST max. So as per the clause number 26.5.1.1b, the maximum area of steel, maximum area of steel in a tension zone is given by, this is for flexure, right? So means tension zone. So here for this AST max, so we are having as per this clause, the value for AST max is equal to 0.004 BD. This will be the value they given, 0.004 B into D. This will be the value we need to refer. Sorry, this is AST max is 0.04 B into D. 0.04 B into D. Nothing but 4%. Maximum AST should be 4%, nothing but 0.04 B into capital D will be the maximum AST we need to provide. So means 0.04 into B value is 250 we provided, overall depth we provided 500, okay. So in that 4%, 0.04 divided by 100, nothing but 4% of the total cross sectional area will be the maximum AST as per this class. So we got the maximum AST, means AST max will be 5000. After calculation we got it as 5000 mm square, okay. So we provided 942.47, required is 899.23, and minimum is 246.3, and AST max is 5000 mm square. So AST minimum will be lesser than what we have provided, that is AST provided, and AST provided is lesser than AST max. AST max, then it is okay. It is ends okay. You just observe, if AST minimum is greater than AST provided, okay, and that case, that will be a second case. So here you may get 150 mm square, but AST minimum will be 246. At that condition, go for provide minimum area of steel, provide 246 only, don't provide 150 or below this value. If you are getting, don't provide that value, provide the minimum value only. But in our case, so AST provided will be 942, but minimum will be 246, maximum will be 5000, which is within the limit itself. Maximum and minimum value within the range only we have the area of the steel. So we can provide this required area of steel, hence provide the required area of steel. If another case, in the third case, if it is maximum, if it is more than the maximum, so if you are getting 7000 mm square, don't provide that much, because the maximum itself 4%, nothing but 5000 mm square. So redesign the entire section. So in our case, it is within the limit, so ends okay. Okay, then required or provided AST is okay, ends okay, or you can write required area of steel is provided. Required area of steel is provided. We have provided AST.